On this Memorial Day, we present an encore presentation of our conversation with Michael J. Fox. His book is now number one. He has testified before Congress, and his courage as he lives with Parkinson's disease has inspired many.
I find myself here with this now. It doesn't feel like, hey, I've ended up here. It feels like, oh, this is where I am now.
Right.
And so I wonder where I'll be. And I don't know. I'm not going to spend a lot of time creating dark scenarios about where that is. But based on what this journey has been so far, I'm going to stick around. You know, wake up curious.
Michael J. Fox for the Hour, coming up.
Charlie Rose is made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
Michael J. Fox is here. Throughout his career, he has created lovable characters in film and television that audiences have fallen in love with. Alex Keaton in Family Ties, Marty McFly in Back to the Future, and Mike Flaherty in Spin City.
Well, I think I've got about everything.
Yeah, anything you forgot, I'll just bring in.
Okay.
Sir, wait a minute. I didn't know you used herbal extract. It's my shampoo, isn't it, sir?
Didn't I bring that with me?
No, you know, I thought both your suitcase and your hair looked fuller.
So I accidentally took your shampoo.
And my conditioner. Sir. My pumice stone? It's all right. You just keep those. I am going to have to charge you for the robe.
Thanks for having me, Mike. You know, I just don't think I could have...
There's no need to explain, okay? We'll just behave like those people that crash in the Andes and not talk about it. He's gonna find out. That's who's gonna find out.
Don't worry, he won't fire you.
Oh, there's no way I'm gonna get a raise out of this.
Vera, what's the company car doing in the driveway?
It broke down, darling. The driver had to take the train back to town.
No, he didn't, darling. He's in here having trouble with his fly. Get back, do you ever stop?
No.
How am I gonna get home now, huh? You wanna tell me that?
Maybe we'll just have to keep you here and adopt you.
You're right, Vera.
A couple of more clicks, we'll take a break.
I thought you were kidding last night, Sarge.
Well, I was serious as a heart attack, you know that.
Yeah, I know, that's what I mean. I mean, this is kidnapping, ain't it, Sarge?
I take the point. Go relieve Hatch on point.
Why?
You got the point. Go!
Yeah, right.
An explanation! Jesus Christ, Dad, an explanation! Look at me! Look at you!
It's not as bad as it looks.
Wait a minute, Dad. I mean, you knew about this? You knew about this and you didn't tell me?
I was hoping I wouldn't have to. Sometimes it skips a generation. I was hoping it would pass you by.
Well, Dad, it didn't pass me by. It landed on my face!
Listen, this is my president, and in this country, it is not only permissible to question our leaders, it's our responsibility. But you already know that, don't you, Mr. President? Because you have a deeper love of this country than any man I've ever known. And I want to know what it says to you that in the past 7 weeks, 59% of Americans have begun to question your patriotism.
Look, if people want to listen to...
They don't have a choice! Bob Rumson is the only one doing the talking! People want leadership, Mr. President, and in the absence of genuine leadership, they'll listen to anyone who steps up to the microphone. They want leadership. They're so thirsty for it, they'll crawl through the desert toward a mirage, and when they discover there's no water, they'll drink the sand.
Hey, Mr. McClary! Be careful you don't get another hook in your finger!
Don't worry, Doc! We're not using hooks today!
In 1991, during the filming of Doc Hollywood, he was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. He went public with the illness in 1998, Since then, he has stepped away from acting and dedicated himself to bringing awareness to Parkinson's. He founded the Michael J. Fox Foundation and testified on Capitol Hill in support of stem cell research and increased federal funding. His new autobiography, Lucky Man, details the past 10 years in dealing with Parkinson's. I am pleased to have him back at this table. Welcome back.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
It's really good to have you here. Lucky Man, some might say, at first glance. Michael has an extraordinary sense of positive energy about his life, because here was a guy who had everything, and now he has everything, but he has spent the last 10 years knowing that, you know, he has a new challenge.
Well, I refer to it in the book, and I had previously referred to it as a gift, and I realized that, you know, that kind of people are taken aback by that a little bit, and, you know, and I modified it to say, well, it's the gift that keeps on taking, but it's a gift, and I mean it in the sense that when something like this comes into your life, there's a variety of reactions you can have to it, and I had them all. But ultimately, what happened was that it necessitated me taking a whole new approach to the way I did things, the way I operated, the way I looked at life, and it made my life so much fuller, in a way. In order to accommodate, I had to take so much stuff out of my life, and it was stuff I didn't need.
Yeah.
And in the absence of all that stuff, I found I had a much fuller, much richer life.
I wish for everybody. I mean, you're not the first person I've heard that from. And I wish that I could understand it more and right. Help me understand it, because I had a friend who died of cancer after a year of diagnosis. And he said to me repeatedly, this has been the most extraordinary year of my life. Right. Well, it had to do with his children, had to do with his wife, it had to do with understanding what was real and not real, or as he said, you know, what matters most.
It's very individual, and I couldn't begin to draw a comparison or relate it to a terminal illness, because I don't know about that.
But help me understand what it's done for you in terms of what's valuable to someone.
Well, I mean, that's one of the reasons I wrote the book. Outside of the primary reason, which was that I was starting up the foundation, and right. It afforded us a good amount of seed money to get going, which was terrific. And then once having taken it on and taking it on seriously and deciding to write it myself, the goal was really to explain that. And I realized that I'd come out with it in a public way and presented it in my current state of mind, which is pretty relaxed, and I have a certain, you know, philosophy about it and an optimism about it. And I realized after a little while that there are other people that are going through it. They might look at that and say, why am I not that? Why am I not that settled with it? Why am I having such a hard time dealing with it? And I thought, well, it'd be a good thing to sit down and explain this, and explain that there really was 7 years before anybody knew I had this, where I really went through, you know, that, like I say, in the book, this laundry list written by the Swiss woman I'd never met, you know, the Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, 5 stages, in really stark ways, and you know, you do, you go through all of these things where things start to fall away. For example, with me, I'd always been a very social drinker, and then found that once I was diagnosed, I was still drinking, but it was the quantity was perhaps less. The quality had changed in an ominous way, in the sense that it was not celebratory. It was joyless and very much about trying to hide from the disease. And you know, I got rid of that from my life, and I got rid of other things, and started to really look at my relationships with people, and really what this meant, and what my work meant to me, and what celebrity meant to me, and all the various aspects of my life. And really started to understand that there are things perhaps that I couldn't do that I used to do.
Sure.
But there are things now that I can do because I've found something else. Yeah, there's an expression I use in the book, which is, I couldn't be still until I could no longer be still. I was very frantic, you know, kind of running all over the place. Yet I had no kind of inner stillness, and the great irony is that now that I'm a very difficult time being physically still, I have no problem at all being emotionally still, and having a kind of a serenity and a peace about things, in the sense, you know, also I can't multitask now. So I can't do two, three or four things at a time. So I can only do the thing that's in front of me, and I can give that everything I have. And at the same time, I can get everything from that it has to offer me, because I'm not looking at other things. I'm not able to look at other things. So that I get the whole of whatever that is, you know, whether it's my child, any of my children, or a project that I'm working on. Someone had asked me the other day about the fact that I was a physical actor and I'd done all these physical things. And did I miss that, that physical freedom? And I said, yeah, but I had never written a book before, and I never would have written a book. I never would have explored that process and that creative, avenue. So, it like I said, it's very difficult to really boil it down and say, this makes me lucky.
Yeah. And you're not saying this simply because you have no choice now. There is enough sort of wisdom and intelligence and a sense of perspective to say it because you genuinely have come to that realization about Michael J. Fox.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's you can't...
It's not just living with what I have, but it's much more of a profound sense of what matters most.
No, it's not just happy optimism. It's not just, you know, it really is a decision that I made down the line. I mean, I also have, again, because it's been 7 years, or it's now been 12 years, but it was 7 years up to the point where I told people about it. I mean, there's a track record for this, you know, kind of emerging philosophy and attitude. Yeah. And it's been a really successful, by my terms, track record, in the sense that decisions that I made, looking at, you know, whether it was to do the television show, right, or whether it was to expand our family, or whether it was to make certain lifestyle choices that we made, or whether, you know, they always seem to have led me to a positive next thing.
You've been asked this before as well. Most things that I can ask, you've been asked before, not just in terms of television interviews, but in a sense of by a whole range of people who are interested. If you were cured tomorrow, if stem cell or some other research would deliver on its promise and immediately, what then? What would, you know?
Oh boy, that's a nice thing to consider. But I haven't considered that any more than I've considered what if it never happens.
Yeah.
I don't spend a lot of time with either of those.
Because you can't control it.
Because I can't control it. I mean, I think, you know, the scenario you're putting across, which is tomorrow, miraculously, right. I can kind of cope with the idea of it happening within the next 10 years.
And most scientists can as well.
Yeah, but if it really were to happen tomorrow,
I mean, would you launch into acting? Would you launch into other?
I'd probably be still and realize, you know, I would, this new stillness I have would be a choice.
Yeah.
You know, it would be a choice, and I would, I think I would just enjoy some time with my family, and then who knows. But, you know, the thing about it, and the thing I write about it in the book, and I think it's a great thing with all this stuff. It's like, you know, Susan Sontag talked about it, illness as a metaphor and other things. It takes a while to get to the point where you realize this isn't personal. You know, that it isn't about being ill, isn't a personal thing.
This is getting beyond why
me. Selected for this, yeah.
Yeah.
So in the same way, in the efforts that we're doing with the foundation, in hopes of a cure and affecting research, you know, and all that stuff is it's not personal. I don't.
What is it then?
It's seeing an opportunity to move things along in a natural direction, in a sense. And I've just been excited about being alive in a time when, you know, this happens to be Parkinson's because it affected me, but, and so I found myself in that situation. But as I looked at it, I said, wow, this really could happen now. And the thousands and thousands of years that people have been dealing with this, as I used to joke with my son, you have to understand my son to know why this is a joke, but, but, you know, 2,000 years ago, you know, people like me, they'd boil in oil, you know, I mean, they didn't know what to make of us. So to go from God knows what happened before then, to the last couple thousand years, to now, where in my life, in my little 70 years, if I'm lucky, or 80 years, this could happen.
I'm doing a program about stem cell today and regenerative medicine for 60 Minutes, and you know we're talking to people who are saying exactly what you're saying.
It's true. It's unbelievable. It's unfathomable, and it's so exciting and so invigorating and energizing.
Okay, let me just leave one more question about that before I leave it. I mean, do you live with the hope? I know lots of friends who are living with some one disease or the other.
Right.
You know, and they live with the idea is that I just want to make sure I'm alive every day, and realizing yours is not life-threatening, because I want to be here when they find the cure, when they find the thing that will, you know, whether it's derived from stem cell or something else in different diseases. Do you live with the idea that somehow around the corner there is coming a cure?
I absolutely do, but in a sense, too, it's depersonalized in a way, in that I'm excited about it in the large sense, in because for me, again, you know, it's what some of the things I talk about in the book. There's been my life has been so front loaded with blessings. I mean, there's so much stuff happening in my life that other people perhaps haven't been fortunate enough to experience. I mean, I have this beautiful wife and four beautiful children, and I have my health in other areas.
And you have a bunch of people who care about you who don't know you but care about you because of your career.
Yeah, and I've been able to accomplish things at an early age and all that stuff. So that I don't need that for my happy thing. You know, I won't feel, you know, that I've been smitten, that I've been, you know, something has come down on me if that doesn't happen.
You've been to peaks that most people don't even reach in a lifetime.
Yeah, but I'm excited about. I'd love to see this happen. I just love to see, because also, as you know, that if a lot of these avenues of research come to fruition, it's not just about Parkinson's. It's about MS, cancer,
sure, absolutely.
ALS, all of these things. And it'd be amazing to be a part of.
Since we've mentioned it before, I forget about it. The foundation is geared up to do what?
Well, really, we're like a guerrilla outfit. The reason that I wanted to get involved was not really, and I've said this before, I didn't come out with my diagnosis in a sense, I didn't come out with the idea of being some kind of hero advocate or any of that stuff. I didn't, you know, I just couldn't hide it anymore. It was very difficult. But as I looked around, I saw all these terrific organizations that had been in place, but essentially kind of bureaucracies and I don't necessarily mean that in a pejorative sense, but just these foundations, and I talked to scientists and I saw these opportunities and I said what we really need is to get a very entrepreneurial, very built for speed, very energetic, very competitive group of people together, and really, change the way this is done. So you know we've been able to do things, for example, in our first full year. We've initiated 57, I think, different areas, grants totaling about $16 million.
You know,
we've directed different funds. We've influenced the NIH into adopting our fast track process for processing applications, and we've instigated new areas of research and new avenues of getting to different groups of people and. So it's been amazing, and that's really what we've tried to do, is just say, let's throw out all the old rules, and let's draw a 10-line mark, a 10-year line, and let's get there.
Just for those who may not know, who know Parkinson's and the effect it has, tell us what it is.
It's basically there's a part of your brain called the substantia nigra that has these cells that produce dopamine, which is a neurochemical. It's the way your brain communicates with your body, and controls movement. What happens is the cells that produce this dopamine die for whatever reason, nobody knows. And once they die, and once they begin to die in great numbers, you begin to lose authority over your physical movement. And it's kind of like your brain is talking to your body on a cell phone in a tunnel. So there's the medical therapies, the pharmaceutical therapies that exist are levodopa, artificial dopamine, which you know, approximates the function of that chemical, but in time it becomes less effective.
And what they hope is stem cells will be able to regrow those cells.
Yes, exactly. Well, that's the thing. You have cells, in the case of embryonic stem cells, that are pluripotent. They can be anything. Right. They don't know what they want to be yet. They haven't developed into a specific purpose, so that you put them in the substantia nigra, for example, you put them in, if someone is diabetic, you know, you put them in
the
pancreas or wherever, and then they become new cells.
Now, there was an experiment that was a setback. What was that?
Well, what happened with that was, I believe that was fetal cells, but too much dopamine was produced.
Yeah.
So that then you get into what's called dyskinesia, which is actually what I'm experiencing right now, which is a kind of a rolling, uncontrolled movement, which is separate from Parkinson's. It's a reaction to too much dopamine, or in my case, artificial dopamine. The good news is there that they got the brain to produce dopamine, but then how do you control the way that it's produced and the amount in which it's produced? So, you know, there's work to be done in that, and you know that's something that we in the foundation are exploring as well, which the causes and the ways to deal with dyskinesia. But it's happening.
Do you have any regrets? Would you have done it differently?
Done what differently?
Would you have come public earlier? Would you have responded differently? Did you lose time? All of that.
Well, I don't think so. Yeah. I mean, I really can't see. I needed every second of the time that I took to be able to understand in the way that I understand, in order to have my life in the shape that it had to be in, to be able to
focus.
to do the things outside of my kind of my inner life, my private life, and regrets are kind of useless.
Yeah, I know. I don't mean regrets about it, regret that I have this, but regrets in a sense that. And how hard was it to go public?
It was very difficult. It was because, you know, even writing the book, you know, it's very counterintuitive for me to, you know, to do that.
It's like reading your own obituary.
Yeah, or writing your own obituary.
But in
a lot of cases, the first flush of press when I came out was like that. It was like seeing my obituary. But and knowing that it was my, you know, once I kind of claimed it, a lot of my struggle was owning the fact that I had this disease.
So you owned it.
Yes, so I can understand that had it.
Right.
And so then 3 years down the road after having done that, or 4 years, now I'm letting it out and realizing, well, now I'm letting the genie out of the bottle.
Yeah.
And there's no way I can pull it back. And once I've, you know, I talked to People magazine and Barbara Walters, and there you go. I mean, people in, like, Uganda now know. And
there you go.
And it's out there. And you know, like I say in the book, you know, that I let the genie out of the bottle, and I don't know whether or not it's going to be, you know, angry at me for having kept it captive for so long, and I have no control over the way, you know, all of a sudden I now have, my wife and I are no longer the sole moderators of any conversation about Parkinson's with my children, that's now, you know, the teachers and friends,
and
all of a sudden it's out there. So, yeah, there was a real feeling once I did it, oh my God, you know, and then I kind of went into hiding for a couple of days as the story was breaking. And I got this sense, you know, I understood that it was becoming this big story, and
huge.
That didn't make sense. But I was getting all these messages, and you see a message from Dan Rather, something's up. I
mean, yeah. Dan Rather. What did Dan say? I mean,
Pat O'Brien, maybe, but Dan Rather. So and then
the difference.
And then it got to a point where really, you know, I thought, well, I don't want to watch TV, and I don't want to see it, and then I thought, well, I'll check my email, and I put on AOL, and there was my picture, and I half expected the guy to say, you know,
fighting for his life, those kind of stories.
Welcome, you've got Parkinson's.
Yeah. Now, what did you hear from people who are living with Parkinson's?
Well, that was a great thing. Well, then I started to understand. First of all, I started to understand that the reaction was really measured and really empathetic. It wasn't one of pity, and it wasn't one of, it wasn't mawkish, and it wasn't.
The worst thing is pity. The worst thing could possibly happen.
I couldn't begin to deal with that. And that wasn't there. And then I realized there was this conversation starting about Parkinson's. It was this national conversation about it. And about young onset Parkinson's and all this stuff. And then I started to go to the websites and to the chat rooms of different Parkinson's groups and started to hear them talk about being considered differently in the world now. because people could relate it to someone else that they knew. And in a way, they were getting something from it, and I was learning a tremendous amount from them. And all of a sudden, it was like looking in a window and seeing the lights on. And it was a fantastic feeling for me. Again, it was this thing of depersonalizing it.
I mean, now there's Janet Reno, and there's Pope Paul, John Paul II, and there is Michael Kinsley, and there's Yasser Arafat. And
it's a really strange group of people.
when the doctor first diagnosed you, you said you wanted to kill him.
Well, I didn't want to kill him. I was just really pissed at him.
Yeah.
Yeah, I hated his guts.
Because he was bringing you this news.
Oh, yeah. I mean, and it was just so, you know, this poor guy, this diagnosing physician, I mean, he was great.
I know, I would think that'd be the guy.
I say in the book, you know, that, how good he was at his job and how tough it must be to lay this on someone my age. And
you were out at that
good
time.
And I hated his guts. Yeah. I was not quite 30.
Yeah. And who did you want to tell other than your wife?
Nobody.
Nobody.
I mean, I told my mother, I told my siblings, but no, I just needed to. I was really at that point in my life, again, and it's one of the reasons I read a lot about celebrity in the book, because you need to understand what that's like to be in your 20s and have a fleet of luxury cars in your driveway and you basically live in a world of live in a world of unlimited possibility.
Exactly.
And then someone say something so implacable, and so definite, and say, no, your life is not what you want it to be, your life is not what you think it is, it's this other thing, it's this disease that old people have, I couldn't even begin to process it. So my first instinct was get out of here and go figure this out, and go figure out how I can negotiate this, how I can weasel it, how I can charm my way out of it, negotiate my way out of it, perform my way out of it, do whatever I have to do. So that was a difficult, that took a couple of years to really realize that wasn't possible. So the initial reaction, I went back and told my wife, and I said to her, it'll be okay. What will be okay? I had no idea.
Yeah, but it will be okay.
It will be okay, because we know, that's the thing about this. This is not a thing where you're in the middle of the street and see a bus coming, or being hit by a bus. This is like being in the middle of the street and being told there's a bus like 14 blocks away that, at some point is going to hit you very slowly.
Yeah.
And you have no way of understanding it. So then I had to educate myself, and I did that reluctantly because, again, I wanted to learn about this disease that I wanted to convince myself I didn't have. So it was a really long process.
And slowly, you finally decided to go public because?
Well, the first reason was really because I was doing this show, and in my life, I was having to deceive people constantly.
Yeah.
And come up with excuses why I couldn't do things, and be very flaky in a way. And in that, I was always waiting for medication to kick in, so. Tell the audience I'll be out in 10 minutes, or I'll be in that meeting in 5 minutes, or not showing up for things, or whatever. And there was this great white elephant in my life that I couldn't claim, And it became very difficult to do the things that I wanted to do. When I still had the ability to do them, it was just that I couldn't do them in so defined a construction as my schedule in my life was at that point. I needed some leeway. And so it was really a matter of relief for myself. And so that's what I'm saying. It wasn't this selfless thing where I thought, well, I'm going to do some good for people and come out with this. I really needed to just make my life more livable. And I realized the only way I could do that was if I told people. And my last, one of the things that was holding me back was the fact that I was doing comedy. And I thought, well, how can the audience laugh at somebody they know is sick? How can you not feel like a jerk? And because timing depends on a certain amount of the audience's trust and their attention and being able to misdirect them in a sense. That I thought if they're looking at me, see if I'm twitching or tremoring or rigid or doing something, and then their mind is off what I'm trying to do as a performer, and I'm sunk. Well, I finally got to the point where that was irrelevant. It just was too difficult to go on and not tell people. So I did, and then this other thing opened up to me, which is, again, the warmth and the empathy that people showed me, the opportunity I saw to be a part of a conversation, and then ultimately the opportunity I saw to move along an agenda which had a foreseeable outcome, positive outcome.
In writing the book, are you surprised that the first thing people latched onto was the drinking?
No, it's interesting too, because it was one of the things about coming out with the fact that I had the illness 7 years after being diagnosed was the way that people kind of reacted to me as if I had just been hit by a bus. And my thinking was, I was hit by it 7 years ago. Yeah. I'm actually better now. In the same way, too, with, you know, I quit drinking 10 years ago. I haven't had a drink in 10 years. So to have a lot of conversations about alcohol is very funny to me because it's so much not a part of my life. But having said that, you know, and it's sexy, it's interesting, you know, in terms of excerpts and serializations. But I think it's also important. It's one of the reasons why I wrote the book, is that there are these coping tools that we go to. And that was a coping tool that I went to. And it doesn't work. And so, in that, you know, if I could save anybody
from that,
an extra couple of drinks.
What coping tool does work?
Just dealing with the honesty of it, dealing with the truth of it.
It's the only one.
It's the only one. You know, there's a quote I put at the beginning of the book from Thoreau. It pretty much sums it all up. I think it's a little further towards the front.
Yeah. In accumulating property for ourselves or our posterity, in founding a family or a state, or acquiring fame even, we are mortal. But in dealing with truth, we are immortal and need fear no change nor accident. Henry David Thoreau. Says it up, doesn't it?
That's it. If you're looking at that, and also the other thing of it is that you live your life in a different way, in the sense that I have much more compassion for people, much more understanding of what their situation is, what they're dealing with. But I think very little about, because I know I'm trying to do the next right thing, and I know the systems of ethical systems and moral systems that I operate on. I'm not thinking so much about what other people think and how it's going to reflect. I'm just doing the next right thing based on the truths I have in front of me, and that served me well.
Your profession was acting. Do you think much about acting?
Not much. I mean, I do think about, you know, I have a production company, Lottery Hope Entertainment, and we produce television, and I'll continue to do that, and I like to direct. Acting is, you know, acting for me is trying to act like I don't have Parkinson's.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of playing a character. I mean, unless I'm playing a character with PD, the greatest part of that performance is going to be to try to pretend I don't. Which is, you know, which means I don't have other choices and other facilities lost to me in that performance. So I don't think about it a lot. As an actor, you know, before I even had this, I always thought there's some elements of acting that I thought were kind of silly anyway. And so other things I don't miss, you know, I really don't miss sitting around talking with four other actors about, you know, the wah of how the door is opened, or it, you know, it's never.
It just doesn't do it anymore.
It's not doing it for me. But at the same time, too, I can be very moved by a performance.
Yeah, of course, you can enjoy it as a performance.
Absolutely, but I don't think about it a lot. I do think, having written the book, I think a lot more about writing now. And I think I love communicating. And I love that part of acting, and I love that part of producing. And I love that part of writing, which is communicating. And I think that's really what I do, which is to take ideas, to take the experiences I have, and try to get an impression of them, and then pass that impression on, and perhaps color other people's experience with that.
This was easy or hard?
It was hard in the way that any great personal effort is hard.
What does that mean?
Well, because there's a tremendous sense of accomplishment, a tremendous sense of discovery that comes from it. But the metaphor that I always use is that, you know, being an actor or being part of a collaborative art form or medium, you show up every day and there's all these artists and artisans and all these people doing what they do, and it's like a river. And I can show up and have my coffee, get my makeup, you know how this is. And you just step in and you go, oh, the river's flowing this way, and I'll get in with it, and I can kind of move within the currents, but it's going to go. Yeah. And I'm a part of it. I may be the most noticeable part of it, but I'm just part of that river. when you're writing, you wake up every day and you show up at the edge of a lake and you're naked and it's still and there's mist blowing across the top of it and you go, can I get to the other side?
Yeah.
And you do it. And it's tremendous feeling. It's a great feeling.
To be able to, each day, complete a paragraph.
A thought.
And
to go to places.
That's the only way you can do it is paragraph by paragraph by paragraph by paragraph, thought by thought.
And you start to go, do I want to talk about this? And you realize you have very little choice about it, in a sense. But once you start a dialogue in your head and start to really look at some of these things and link things up and say, well, this happened, in a sense, because this happened. And I can't really talk about this unless I talk about this. And then you start to deal with, how does that affect other people in my life? And
That would be the only serious impediment, I would think, is...
It's difficult.
That's really the yet.
Yeah. I had a wonderful experience just in the last couple of weeks that I went up to Canada, and I'd written a lot about my childhood in the book and my relationship with my father, which was who I loved very much. But I always say, in shorthand, my father was a career military man, and I'm an actor. So you there's something went on there, you know?
Yeah, right. That's right.
You figure that one out. And you know, there was some issues.
You didn't go to the military.
And there was, around the time of my father's death, which was just before I was diagnosed, which was the beginning of this kind of wake-up call. I had some issues with my brother and with my family. And so I went up to Canada last week and sent a copy of the book along ahead. And they had read the book and appreciated it for what I was trying to do and were very supportive of me. And it was I didn't even realize how much it had concerned me until I felt the relief that they appreciated it in the way that they did.
Did you call them beforehand and say, listen, you know, I've got to write about these things because it's me and it's my life, and, you know, if I don't do this, then nothing else will be true.
I did, especially with my brother, because there was one particular incident. Around the time of my father's death, my brother was at home, and he dealt with it. He was on the ground. I mean, he was there. And I was in L.A., and he called me up and said, get home. And I'm, you know, at this point in my life, again, it's 1990, I'm, you know, Boy Prince of Hollywood.
Right.
And I'm saying, you know, what does he need? Does he need a chopper, you know, medevac him to Seattle? I'm getting a Learjet over there. And he's just like, just come home. And then I got home, and again, I couldn't, I'm dealing with this reality that's not this Hollywood thing that I've been dealing with for so long. And, you know, what I call my funhouse self, and my funhouse self did not respond well to this this awful, you know, reality, and we almost came to blows, and it was a big turning point for me. And so I called him and I said, you know, I have to write about that. And he was fantastic.
Really, he said, do it.
He said, do it. Yeah.
Tell it the way it was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In fact, having read it, he said, you're hard on yourself. Yeah. You're too soft on me.
Yeah, that's what I thought. He'd say, you're too soft on me, or too hard on yourself. Yeah. Yeah. Other people said that to you?
No, I mean, that was a particular incident where really I felt that I was wrong and he was right, or at least he was less wrong than me. Mm-hmm. But no, I haven't. You know, it's funny with the book too. The other thing, having written it, I'm, other than my family, there's not a lot that I'm worried about in that sense, and I've really tried to be truthful about things. I talked about fame.
Yes.
Again, things get picked up. I talked about fame, and I just mentioned an incident where I was passing by Cher at a thing, and just realizing this is a famous person, and I'm maybe not such a famous person. And that was picked up in a magazine, and I thought, well, you know, it's kind of funny because I wasn't going out, I wasn't making a left turn to go take a shot at Cher. But, you know, I just tried to observe things and mention them as I went along.
When you look, what is the most profound thing, what's the wisest thing you have to say about fame? At this stage, having seen it the way you saw it?
Well, fame, you know, fame is not a function of the famous. It's a function of those that make that person famous.
Yeah.
So that, in a sense, there's nothing material about you as a famous person that's any different.
Yeah.
I mean, other than the acquired things.
Right.
And so that really there's a point where you have to make a decision. Do you want to be a part of the greater humanity, or do you want to live in this bubble? But it's all perception, and so if you if you're too locked into that thing of this perceived reality, then it's very difficult when you need to make the way back to terra firma, you know, which is what I needed to do when all this came down. So
what do you dream now?
What I dream now? You mean in the sense of...
Not in terms of when you put your head on the pillow tonight, what kind of dream you have, that would be a little bit...
Well, I certainly have hopes and confidence in a world where
the possibility of managing Parkinson's.
Managing Parkinson's, managing other disease, and then you know, also ultimately just a reprioritization of the way we look at things and what we view as important. And I think it's a macro version of the micro version that was, you know, my life and my experience. But you know, it's we get sidetracked by things, you know, and we lose the possibilities that are in front of us.
There is something there in that idea. We lose the possibilities that are within us, that I think is at the heart of all those conversations I've had with people, you know, who've gotten very smart because they've had to face some huge challenge, living with a disease, whether it's terminal or not, or something else happened that has brought to them the notion of understanding the possibilities that they would never have even scratched the surface. I mean, I think that is...
And there's other things, too, that you realize that these small things, you know, on the way to those bigger thoughts. But, you know, now, it's not like I went through this whole thought process to get here, but now if someone were to say to me, well, if so-and-so only knew what I'm going through, then, you know, and in my mind I think, well, then what? No, if they knew, they wouldn't care. It doesn't matter.
Yes.
It doesn't matter. None of that stuff matters. It doesn't, you know, it's just not important. Which is not to say, oh, this heavy thing I'm dealing with is important. That's not in its own way important either. What's important is just do the right thing, take the next step. What can we do?
Exactly.
What's in front of us? How can we? And I don't think that there's anything better that we could do than to make the lives of the people around us better, and by extension our own lives better, and by extension our children's.
And that
lives
applies
better
to everybody, whatever their status or condition or everything else.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's like the thing where you just about take a brief sidetrack to stem cells. You look at the president in the summer before, you know. Hell broke out all over the world in September, but in that last summer, the big issue was stem cells, and it's a big national conversation.
And he was saying at that time, this may be the most important decision I'll make during my presidency.
Right, and I think that it was a pretty big decision, and in ways it was very important. And he kind of bunted, you know, he moved us forward, but in a very tentative way.
Right.
But had he moved in a really forthright way, and I'm grateful that he did as much as he did. But he really could have, within an 8-year, for example, term, he could have wrapped this up if he'd really said, let's go after this now.
Yeah. No.
In the same way that hopefully we'll be able to accomplish an agenda with terrorism and the war on terrorism. I think there's room even with that to really attack these social ills and these medical issues it faces, and really,
you know what it's done. I mean, what's interesting about things like it's brought a lot of people to the idea of stem cells because they have a personal connection. What because of it, the issues of abortion that have visited, that are somehow part of the dialogue with respect to stem cells because it's embryonic that have the most power today. Because of that connection, many people who might be opposed to stem cell are not, simply because they have a connection with someone else. You know, their ideology says do this, their humanness says don't, because my brother has Parkinson's and I understand the choice.
I wrote an op-ed for the New York Times just prior to the election and talked about the fact that a lot of, you know, Orrin Hatch, I mean, a lot of real, you know, pro-life conservative Republicans are in favor of this research for those very reasons. And that's one of the difficult things about having the conversation because like from my own experience, I mean, I so respect people's ethical or religious conviction and completely understand that. And I'm willing to have a conversation about that. The unfortunate thing is from the other side, sometimes you get these very strident, very graphic, very charged characterizations of what it is. And that aren't accurate and then aren't representative and stop the conversation. So, you know, the thing is that this is going to move ahead anyway. So do we as a country take a position of responsibility and by funding it, oversee it? Or do we let it just kind of happen on the margins, slow it down, but do nothing to stop its inevitability? Yeah, that's really the thing.
Yeah. It's the closer you get to it, the closer you get to talking to people that have a deep awareness of the possibilities, the more it becomes. I've had, in the last week, I've talked to some of the best scientists in the world. In three cases, these medical researchers said to me, if I was just coming to research today, the place I'd want to be is stem cell. That's where I'd want to be.
Right.
Because that's what offers the most amazing potential for all of us.
We and our foundation started an RFA to find a dopaminergic cell line.
Yeah.
And we did that pretty much around the same time as the president came down with his decision. We had it in place. And we have amazing scientists from the United States and,
right.
and some from Sweden working on this. And that's what we as a foundation wanted to do, too, which was to energize scientists and get them involved in this field. And it is. I mean, this is going to be the big breakthrough.
In memory of Dad and Nana, I assume Nana is...
My grandmother.
My grandmother. Dedicated with all my love to Tracy, your wife. She's been amazing in this.
She's been great. And
more than great, yeah.
You know, but in a way that is so not... I just want to be careful when I describe this, because... Because it's not to say it's not the things that people imagine, but I think people envision this kind of caretaker-y.
Yeah, right.
But you know, it's the ball busting and the.
What do you mean by ball busting?
Well, keeping me engaged in life and keeping me, you know, not you know, kind of saying, well, you
well,
know.
Hey, hello.
Yeah, hello with the program.
Come on.
You know, and
you're not the only person living with Parkinson, Michael.
Yeah, exactly. Or you're not the only person that's living with something.
Right.
And you know, and Tracy has a tremendous sense of irony, a tremendous sense of humor,
yeah.
a tremendous wisdom, and is just such a great friend. And, you know, still thinks I'm funny and still thinks I'm kind of sexy. And, you know, so it's great.
That'll take you a long way, won't it?
But, you know, she's fantastic.
All right, Sam.
Yeah, Sam is great. Sam is,
How old is Sam?
He's 13.
Yeah.
He's
the oldest.
Yeah, he's not quite 13.
Yeah.
I know 13 is coming.
It's really. Important. He wants to be a teenager.
Well, I can hear the Hebrew, his Haftorah being chanted from... his room as he prepares for his bar mitzvah. But he's very, very, he's been terrific through this because he's a very kind of clinical mind. He's a very scientific kind of orientation. And it's been great to talk to him about this. And he can really understand it from a point of view of what's happening physiologically and then emotionally. I think that he's been great about the fact that, you know, he's always dealt with the fact that his father is somebody that people relate to in a certain way.
Right.
And I think seeing me on a day-to-day basis deal with this has humanized me in a way for him. And he's responded to that in a really great way. He almost lets me know that he understands that.
Equina.
Equina and Scott.
Yes, how old? How is Equina?
They're seven.
Identical twins.
Yeah. I talk about it in the book that there was a period in between Sam and Aquino, which was six years. This was when I was really going through a difficult time with my diagnosis,
right.
and isolating, and really wondering, you know, why did Tracy love me, and why was she still with me? And one of the things that we never talked about, that we talked about before we got married, was having a lot of kids. And I thought, well, this is, you know, enough not said. I understand in the absence of a conversation about that I am on thin ice here. That there's something happening. And as I started to get better and I started therapy and I started to really deal with my illness and really my outlook changed hugely. And then all of a sudden she said to me one day, you know, Sam would make a great big brother. So then we went ahead and had another baby and then out came these two beautiful girls. And I realized that, you know, it wasn't for me to worry about timing. It wasn't for me to worry about that kind of stuff. That you know, it was almost like these are the two children, this is the children. The child that maybe I thought we didn't have in that time that we could have.
Mm.
And so they're such a blessing, these two.
And then Esme.
Esme is, The thing that I always think about with Esme was that she was born, you know, shortly after September 11th, and born here in New York. And you know, for those of us who know what this is, that live in New York and love this city, it was a very sad time. It was a very difficult time, and we're looking for things about the city that are the same and that we love. And so when Tracy's water broke that morning, the fact that we walked, got her bag, walked downstairs, walked down onto the street, walked 6 blocks up to the hospital, and went into a room and had our daughter was just so simple and so wonderful. And, you know, and I don't know, she has that kind of, she feels like that kind of presence, which is just, you know, things go forward and things are beautiful.
And you end this by saying, and this is, and of course, Mom.
Yeah. Well, my mom was very helpful in writing the book and going through my family history. But you know, the reason I talk about my grandmother and that my mother is tied into this, I talk about it at the beginning of the section that I talk about my childhood. My grandmother, my Nana, this Irish lady, who had two sons who were in World War II. Were POWs, and not at the same time. I mean, one was captured, and before she knew whether he was captured, they'd heard that he was missing, presumed dead. So she had a heart attack. This in the early 40s, and then they found out he was alive, that he'd in fact been captured, was a POW. Then a second son, they get the same telegram, and now her family back east are worrying about her having another heart attack. They're saying, come back east, and she's saying, no, I'm going to wait until I find out what happened to him. She comes down one morning from her bedroom. She says, okay, I had a dream. She saw a white parachute in the sky. She said, he's fine. And so I can go. A couple days later, they found out that he had, in fact, been parachuted and was captured and was fine. And because of that, she was considered this psychic in the family, this person, you know, if she said it was going to rain and it was sunny, you packed an umbrella. And when I was a kid and I was a little crazy, she would say, don't worry about Michael, don't worry about him. He's going to do things you can't even begin to imagine. He's not the person you need to worry about. And when she passed away when I was 10, that was like a trust that she left for me. My parents were the, you know, as I say in the book, the dubious but dutiful executors of them. And so, in fact, the fact that I left Canada when I was 18 to be an actor, and with my parents' blessing, really had to do with my grandmother. So my mother and my grandmother are very kind of tied together for me. Having something to do with the fact, too, that they look very much alike.
You say in the acknowledgments to Aquina and Shiloh, now that Shaky Dad's book is done, I'll be taking you to school more often.
Right.
And to Sam, thanks for making the extra effort with your homework so I'll have more time to do my own. Tracy, my wife, my best friend, I love you. You go on through those. This is just an amazing book because it is a story of a lucky man, because, A, before you met Parkinson's, and then in meeting Parkinson's as well, you know, it is a story of understanding. And I don't know, there must be a great quote about self-discovery somewhere.
Well, and that's the thing of it, is that everybody's got one. Everybody's got a story. And there are strange elements of my story and certainly different circumstances I could not have expected myself to be in. But the journey in and of itself, again, did I find myself here with this now? It doesn't feel like, hey, I've ended up here. It feels like, oh, this is where I am now.
Right.
And so I wonder where I'll be. And I don't know. I'm not going to spend a lot of time creating dark scenarios about where that is. But based on what this journey has been so far, I'm going to stick around. You know, wake up curious, which is all you can ask for.
Michael J. Fox, Lucky Man, a memoir. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. I didn't bounce too far away from the table.
You were just fine.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time. I had a series of clips that I was prepared to have Michael talk about, from Back to the Future, Casualties of War, Doc Hollywood, the American President, Family Ties, where it began. in some ways, of the people that he's worked with, all of these extraordinary directors that have been a part of his life, fellow actors who've been a part of his life, all the stuff that many of them who are friends, but people who make up a part of his life that, as he said, he was the boy prince of Hollywood. And he says eloquently what it in fact is, that this is a journey that continues. And on a journey, you take it where it leads you. Lucky Man, a memoir, Michael J. Fox. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Charlie Rose is made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.